respected session chairs and the academic elite present here. The topic of my paper is Talent Management, Skill Development and Initiatives in India. As it is clear that it is theoretical in nature and not data-based. So it is basically to discuss the skill capacity, skill gaps, and initiatives and challenges facing India. Talent management and skill development form an important strategy for building and developing a vibrant economy, efficient and profitable organization, and enhancing an employee's future performance. So issue facing today is not dearth of professionals, but an acute shortage of talented professionals globally. So talent management includes recruiting talent, that is entry-level skills, training and developing talent, that is lifelong learning, retaining talent, that is performance-based incentives, developing leadership talent, or creating talented ethical culture. And from talent management standpoint, employees' evaluation is performance and potential, that is entry-level skills and proper development of skills. Hence, the importance of skill development in talent management of an organization. So objective is to discuss position of India in terms of demographic composition, to highlight skill gaps, government initiatives, and remedies for talent and skill management in the light of challenges facing India. India has advantage of demographic composition. By 2020, the world will have shortage of 47 million people in the working age group, but India will have a surplus of 56 million working people. Being the youngest country of the world with median age of 25 years, 65% of population in the age group 15 to 59, if it properly utilizes the demographic window, it can bring dividends. By 2020, the average age of Indian will be 29 years against 37 years for China, 48 years for Japan and other developed nations. So harnessing the demographic dividend through appropriate skill development efforts is the need of the hour. Accordingly, gaps in skill and talent has been identified from the government and private estimates so as to enhance the skill of entry-level talent and existing employee base in organizations. Ideal organization framework includes listing of key organizational objectives, linking of individual performance goals, well-defined competencies, identification of skill gaps, and use of e-learning entailing personalized learning paths. So the focus now remains on skill gap and employability issues, skill development initiatives, challenges facing skill development, and conclusions in this regard. Skill gap refers to a mismatch between the demand and supply side of workforce. Government of India and its partner agencies have made concentrated efforts to bridge the gap. Despite this, they have failed in achieving their skilling targets. I have taken data from Ministry of Labour and Employment for this. These were the targets meant for the year 2012-13. The first column shows the skilling targets. The second column shows the targets achieved. And third is gaps in the achievement. The consolidated figure comes out to be the government and partner agencies have failed in achieving their skilling targets with a wide margin. All of the stakeholders cumulatively achieved a meager target of 53%. There is a private estimate by CII for the recent year, 2015, for all the sectors. As an example, I have taken a construction sector where less skills have been framed. You see, it was only the initial data that I discussed. There we have a cumulative figure. Here it is by level of skills. So improvisation is there. Specialized skills, skill category 1, skill category 2, minimal education scalable. So these are how the skill gaps are these days being framed. So India adds 12 million people to its workforce every year. 10% of the Indian labor force is trained formally or informally, against 95% in South Korea, our competitors, 80% in Japan, 75% in Germany, so we are placed quite behind. 53% of employers in India complained that lack of skills was a leading reason for entry-level vacancies. Today, India has the capacity to train about 20% of new workers. Training of remaining 80% is a big question mark. If current trend persists, the country is likely to have 30 to 35 million more low-skilled workers than employers will demand in the year 2020. So our workforce readiness is one of the lowest. Existing training infrastructure is inappropriate, and we, you know, that we lead in the tertiary sector. Our exports are mainly from tertiary sector. India has projected to contribute 27% of the global growth in tertiary educated sector, but there quality remains a big problem. Graduates of Indian engineering and computer science colleges still need to be trained extensively and to be made job ready. Here comes the picture educational sector. Education and vocational training are important contributors to skill capital tool, school education, higher education, vocational training, which includes training dropout of mainstream education at all levels, and professional courses through increasing use of ICT, that is digital technology, increased private sector participation. Government itself can't do the work, and we know they are PPPs. So this is the whole structure, and wherever, at every level, there can be a dropout, and we need to develop skill-oriented programs for the dropouts. Vocational training is offered by Department for Director General of Employment and Training. Two things, schemes are listed here, but the administration of it rests with the state. So this is stupendous task is being done. And the recent government initiatives, they include National Skill Development Policy, modular employable skills, and the upgradation of government ITIs, for which funding has come from World Bank, public-private partnership, even Director General of Employment and Training. And the modular skills focus on need-based training and acquiring employable skills within short time frames. So these can be the most useful domain for training our workforce. Then we have micro, small and medium enterprises, where maximum employment is concentrated, and it leaves the livelihoods department through jobs creation and access to skill-based employment. Hence, it is the most important segment. Most of the time, what happens in MSMEs, that it is the on-the-job training that happens, but we need to develop courses for developing SMSEs. Then there is National Skill Development Corporation. It has functions filling gaps of national vocational training system, identifying high growth sectors, and there what are the incremental skill gaps, accordingly framing courses for that. Sectoral skill councils, skill development centers with public-private partnership model, and creation of labor market information system so that we have first-hand information. So it is a three-tier institutional structure for skill formation, which I won't discuss. But we have National Skill Development Corporation under National Skill Development Agency. It prepares reports of skill gap analysis on sectoral basis, on state basis. So we have different data on, we have complete data on that. Under it is sector skill councils, which have national skill quality framework, which governs that, labor market information system, national occupation standards, and then certification of these courses. Few examples of international linkages of funding for skills development in India. There is World Bank funded vocational training improvement project, which deals with employment outcomes of graduates in vocational training. German Technical Cooperation funded project with emphasis on informal sector. European Commission funded India EU skills development project for LMIS, and bilateral memorandum of understandings with foreign governments, few mentioned here. For rural youth, there is Ajivika Skill Development Program under National Rural Livelihood Mission. It has different schemes along with its main program, Himayat scheme, Roshni scheme, Parvaz. So the target population is rural youth age group of 17 to 35 years from below poverty line, which works in 12 trades, and 5 million youth has been skilled under it. There are three flagship programs of the government: Skill India, which I have discussed, Digital India to transform India into a digitally empowered society, and Make in India, which has four pillars: new processes, new infrastructure, new sectors, and new mindset. So it is to develop manufacturing sector, so that, because we know that manufacturing sector is not progressing well, emphasis is required on that. Directly from agriculture we have transferred to services sector, so it is required. But for this, skill formation is a challenge. So we come to challenges in skill development: increasing capacity and capability of existing system, including education system, taking care of unorganized labor force. 93% of the labor force is in unorganized sector. Enhancing skill formation in rural areas, where we can have traditional skills also, which can be developed for self-employment. Promoting lifelong learning, maintaining quality relevance. Then there is developing synergy between industry and academia, creating effective convergence between institutions of education, various skill development efforts of government, and between government and private sector initiative through PPPs. Increasing participation of stakeholders, that is a challenge. So now there are certain other challenges. That is, 29% of workforce are not even literate. 24% are having below primary or only primary level of education. Only 16.9% has higher level of education. So mobilizing adequate investment for these programs is a stupendous task for attaining sustainability and by strengthening physical and intellectual resources. Major challenge is to make people employable and help them secure decent work. So skill development for persons working in the unorganized sector is a key strategy in that direction. So coming to conclusion and suggestions. So globalization and rapidly changing technology needs greater intensity of knowledge and skills. All these have led to change in the nature, contents, and types of skill demands, and have intensified the need of highly skilled workforce in firms and industrial sectors. Education and skill building hold tremendous promise for reaping the demographic dividend, just as it poses formidable challenge to be demographic disaster. It is for sustaining momentum of high growth that we need to utilize the advantageous position of demographic dividend also. Vocational training needs to be expanded and reoriented so that youth can develop the skill required for productive employment. A significant number of well-performing professional institutions be developed into institutions of excellence, offering high-quality programs in current and emerging technology, where we lead the nation today, lead the world today, for which they should be generously resourced, equipped with internationally comparable facilities and high quality faculty. We have two ends. One is low skilled workers end, and another is high quality skill end. So we vary from very low level to very high level. So in between there is a wide range, wide diversity, which needs to be maintained or need to be taken care of through planning various skill programs for that range of labor. Ensure that existing unlimited supplies of unskilled labor and unorganized labor are utilizable. Ensure the current inelastic supply of skilled labor to be more elastic. Training of the top notchers in disruptive technologies such as big data, artificial intelligence, and 3D printing that we listened in the morning session, so as to compete globally. Coordinating the efforts and initiatives of the government, center and state both, various organizations, the private sector, NGOs, and educational academia so that is required. And the, in the end, I wanted to show a slide where it is that we need to develop localized skills with global mindset. That will be the appropriate strategy to develop skills. Thank you.
Any question for her? Do you have any new business model that accelerates this talent management?
No, because I don't come from a commerce background. Actually, I come from economics background. There we need to have a representative sample. So for all the low end to high end skills, it was very difficult to have a sample and work on that. But it can be. For further research, it would be very useful that we go with the questionnaires and we find what type of skills are required for rural. Rural areas, we can have a different model. For urban areas, we can have different. So we can segregate like it, and we can come up with some strategy out of that. Till now, I haven't worked on that.
Thank you.